Yeah, I'm coming from a totally different place because early on, I was taking pictures of the family and launched into got my first camera and put myself through college and graduate school with a camera doing weddings, just like John probably did in his day, and was facing the draft. This was back in the 60s that I
There
did
we
this.
go.
So I'm totally 100% self-taught, and I was raised on a little farm in Texas. So what would I do when I wasn't doing weddings was going out and taking pictures of farm implements and all kind of abstracts, doorknobs, old buildings, anything, and that was really good for me to look at that. However, in art school, I have a PhD in physics, and physics is a bit of a mystic kind of a science. We don't believe in things. We actually question reality and what is underlying reality. So left side of the brain and the right side of the brain mix up because they influence one another. And when I look at subjects, I actually look at what's underneath the surface. What calls to me is the beauty of what is below and cannot be seen, and you only see the surface bits of. So all my photography, and by the way, the wedding experience, the wedding photography experience, said as soon as I saw my very first picture in 1978, I said, no more pictures of people. So I've totally left that, and it's all nature photography or places where people have been. Now, having said that, I just lied because I have pictures of two people. But as part of my portfolio. But that's kind of my background. It's a very different background.
So we can go back to Adrian, but I also thought now that we've been looking at landscapes and the beauty of Bodega, I wouldn't mind going over, if everybody is okay with that, to go to Bill Tice's work, because he also makes the most amazing, beautiful landscapes.
Thank
And
you.
it's not about a particular place. Bill travels a lot, or traveled for sure before we had these strange times. And maybe you want to say something about it, Bill?
Oh, absolutely. And not like Johnson, these are like the decisive moment when something happens. The riser goes off, if you see the riser. The frog comes into the lily pad. He doesn't stay there very long.
Here, the frog, right?
Yeah, the frog is in there. In fact, I didn't even realize he was there until I got home. The cloud comes through the eucalyptus. Go ahead and move the screen up a little bit, and you'll see the beast down there, bowling ball beast, passing if you raise it up and
Good,
it,
no. Ah, the other three, no, this three.
yes, okay. So
Okay.
these are all decisive moments. Now, show me the other three. Or lower.
A bit lower now, yeah.
Yes, please. Okay, so you have sunset there in the middle. That is putting yourself in the right place, and then you only have time for one shot. That's it. And down on Bowling Ball Beach, I went there 7 or 8 times at low tide at sunset, and I had fog and rain and all kinds of terrible things. But on about the seventh or eighth time there, it was beautiful. Here I had the bowling balls all showing, and I had an amazing time taking that photograph. Now, when I say taking one, many of these photographs were made with an 8x10 view camera. There is no light meter. There is only a single sheet of film that you use, and it costs you $20 every time you take a picture. you're very careful about taking pictures. So, and you also learn a lot about photography. Many photographers today don't know how to shoot pictures because their camera's automatic and it does everything. I use my camera solely manual, and I use the digital just like it's a piece of film. I still use a handheld light mirror for the most part, and use knowing how photography works and how optics works, I'm able to hit these kind of images. I never had, only in the last few years have I ever had digital, and that was using digital on a view camera, so that's not exactly the point and shoot digital. All these things are to honor the subject, to have the subject come forward. And when you see one of these prints, it's just like standing there and being in the moment, except nothing is moving. It's a static point in time that captures what I believe is a beautiful subject.
It is.
Anybody, I mean,
yeah.
What more is there to say? This is back to, you know, this is showing you more than what's really there. The whole planet is very, very beautiful. And we are part of the cosmos, maybe the only part of the cosmos that can recognize and be sentient and recognize beauty at all. That's what art is trying, except some art is trying to be anti-art and capture ugliness. But in general, art is capturing the beauty of our surroundings, whether it's abstract and printmaking or painting. Very much this is like a painter. A painter puts himself in a beautiful place and waits for the right light and tries to capture that as quickly as possible, finishing it up in the studio. That's plein air. This is plein air too, in a way, because after I made the photograph on film, I wasn't done. I had to scan the film. I had to bring it to Photoshop and restore the vision that I had when I took the image. Film doesn't capture what, and cameras, a digital camera, does not capture what you saw. And when you hit back, there's a two-stage process. You capture it, and now you restore it. You remove the hash. You make the color correct. You can enhance the color, and that's the art. The whole package. And it's a lot of darn work.
It's all hard work. It's all hard work.
Each one of these images represents a lot of work getting there, a lot of knowledge about the canvas, taking the picture, and then making the picture. There's at least 72 hours spent on the picture to play it.
Yes. Yes, I'd like to know about who was your favorite mentor or your favorite teacher or someone who was of extreme influence, you know, in your work. Well, you know, what, I mean, it will be very individual, of course. And maybe there's no one, but there's always someone that I would like to hear about. And I don't know who would like to give an answer to that one.
Well, I would have to say that mine is a photographer named Elliot Porter, who does very beautiful, quiet. It's just, you're there at the moment. And it's not these grand things like Ansel Adams. It's little things. It's little things that speak to you. And so I have always admired his work, but I blended a little bit with Brett Weston because I want graphic. Now, Brett is a black and white photographer, and his things are just blindingly, spectacularly graphic and abstract. So I'm kind of always balancing those two things, which are like gasoline and fire together in the same image, and something comes out. Sometimes it's closer to Elliot Porter, sometimes it's closer to Brett Weston, but it's always in that spectrum in there between those two. So they were very highly influential, at least to me.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill.
So my whole purpose of doing virtual studios, well, open studios and now virtual studios, is to actually be able to interact with my visitors. Frequently, they come in, there's a whole bunch of people, I don't get to talk to them. At least right here, I have an undivided, I've got your attention right now, I can talk to you, and any of the other, and fellow artists too.
Yeah.
On your weekends, we don't get to host the other artists.
Right.
We're busy with our own thing.
That's right.
And this is a great opportunity to do that. And I appreciate the ability to, because I'm only trying to share my art. I don't need to sell any of it. I am just wanting to put it out here and share it. And hopefully people that view my art will enjoy it, whether they ever want to own any of it or not. And I really don't care.
Well,
I am just sharing.
Very nice last wise words.